was him that said whoa, not me. Did I say whoa? Amen. Well, welcome everyone online and here in mighty San Diego in the most beautiful weather. Disciples have come out. The right disciples have come out to make sure that our God gets the glory and the praise this morning. First of all, I want to say thank you guys for all your prayers. God has worked tremendously while I was in the hospital. I definitely thank you guys so much for your prayers. And it's just awesome to know that at the end of the day, we are here to worship our God. We're here to worship an amazing God. He came into this world, came into darkness, stepped in, and because he did step in, we have the possibility of being able to have salvation. And we're just so grateful for that. Let's go ahead and open up in a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for this time to be together. Thank you so much for this day. God, I want to pray that you will be with our service today, that you will move tremendously through the disciples here, through those that will come. And God, I just pray that you will help us to stay faithful and true. And God, I want to pray that your spirit powerfully moves through the service today. Father, we love you. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Here I am to worship.
Step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see.
Which you received and on which you have taken your stand. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. And So knowing this awesome word, guys, I want to welcome you to Christ Church Universal, CCU. Let's give it up for God. Thank you all for being here, and let's pray for an amazing church service. Amen. Father, it is just truly amazing to come together as brothers and sisters, knowing all that you have done for us, God, that you have led us here, Father, that you have allowed us to come and worship you, Lord, to put aside all the things going on in our lives, to set a special time just for you, Lord. I just pray that today's worship will be one that is glorifying to you, God, that we can truly cast all of our anxieties to you, Lord, and trust in you in everything we do. We love you. We thank you. Please open our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Blessed be your name. Amen. Here we go. Wait, put it on G.
Blessed be your name, O God. blessed be your glorious name.
Amen. Go ahead and be seated here. Amen. Well, good morning, church, or good evening, should I say. It's so awesome to be here. The title of this evening's message is simply, Build My Church, or Build Christ's Church Together. Building Christ's Church Together. First, I wanted to say thank you so much to all the prayer requests that, all the prayer requests for sure, but thank you so much for my personal prayer requests of you guys answering the prayers of coming through a difficult week. And let me tell you, it's a difficult week when you don't have any control. It's a difficult time when the doctors come in and you think that it's going to go a certain way, and the doctor's saying, no, we need to check you into the hospital. And it was just a pretty challenging time.
I thought it was going to be a quick visit, check on the chest pain.
Found out the chest pain was up to a blood pressure of 215 over 108.
The doctors let me know that that's a near-death situation. And so next thing you know, I'm getting hooked up to all kinds of machinery, giving blood and things like that. And you know, the rest is history. And so, yeah, it was pretty crazy to get checked into the hospital. Jermaine was there, Stephanie was there. Which was great to have them both there. Had some great doctors. One of the doctors was a guy that actually worked with Jermaine when he was working at the hospital. So that made for a nice little family connection. And so, it's just one of those things where you never know. We always say it, right? You never know when your last day is going to be.
You never know, right?
And we always say it. But when it comes home to roost, then all of a sudden it's like, man, yeah, you never know. You really never know. And of course, I kept it pretty light, as I would always do, and try to keep the humor and everything. But when you look over and you see your wife not laughing, and you see your son not laughing, and the doctor's not laughing at the jokes, then you realize that this is a little more serious than it is. I don't know. It's just one of those things. And so I do know this, though, that during the time, It was really cool to be able to rely on God and rely on the brothers and sisters and to rely on you guys' prayer.
That was so cool.
I think I put out a prayer request, and within an hour or so, it had already escalated up to 100 or so people. And then all of you that have reached out to Stephanie and the family and myself, some of you have come to visit while you're in the hospital. It's pretty cool. And you know how it is when you visit the hospital, when you see somebody and you get the face shots on social media, you don't realize how serious it is till you visit, and all of a sudden you see all the things that are hooked up and the tubes and everything. And so, yeah, it was definitely a difficult task. I learned so much after being poked for about 13 or 14 times. I'd gotten so raw that I told the blood work people that, hey, I need to chill right now. We need to find a different part of the body, and my arms can't take any more blood work. And they looked, and they was like, yeah, you're absolutely right, actually. And I was like, yeah, my blood's probably good. You guys got enough blood work by now. And so, yeah, it was a challenging experience. Yet at the same time, it's an experience that I'll never forget because I could rest in Christ. I could rest my spirit in Christ. And I could think about all my loved ones, and I could think about all my brothers and sisters. But I was just peaceful in Christ. And you say, Jermaine, how can you be peaceful in Christ when your heart rate is the same as that of a sprinter running a race and you're just sitting still? And all I can say is that the moment that the prayers began to engage, the medication began to settle in. A short time after that, what we found was that the blood pressure went down, and then we also found that the heart rate went down, and it was a direct correlation with the prayers that were coming in at that same time. And so, obviously, when you're there in the hospital for 4 days, you don't really anticipate that. And so, yeah, it was an interesting experience to learn from, and learned a lot about the family, as they called me every day, every morning, would have jokes. They would all FaceTime. Stephanie would show up early in the morning, of course, and the family would joke and everything. And it's just cool to see the family's faces, and I could see your messages and everything. I got your calls, I got your text, and it's just really peaceful to know that we're family. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's real talk too. That's no phony baloney. That's like, let me tell you, that was cool. And the doctor said that, it's rare to be able to see that kind of support. And it was just really, really encouraging. I think at one point, the blood person was there, the EKG person was there, the doctor was there. My hair was froed out. I don't know if y'all remember last Sunday, it was froed out. So by the second day, it's really like it was all over the place. And Stephanie was there braiding my hair as the doctor is talking and everything. And I was like, Stephanie, can you just at least get the hair like managed or something? And so the doctor's talking and everything. And you could just tell the doctor just kind of settled in, and we had some good conversations, and conversations about God, conversations about church, conversations about, you know, God's people, the church, the support that's coming in. And he was just really blown away. And then, of course, over the course of time, a few people that my wife and I used to lead, different ministries we've been a part of, would come and visit. And so that's also humbling, too. You know, they walk in, they see their former minister in a hospital. I think that shook some of those guys up as well. And one of those families said that she said, this is crazy because we actually live in the same neighborhood of where you guys are meeting, and I had no idea you guys are meeting right there in Mira Mesa. We could actually walk here in 5 minutes. And I was like, okay, well, now I know why God allowed me to come to the hospital, you know, so that you never know. But what I do know is that my confidence in God, though I might not be able to go as loud as I want to go, I think my spirit is even louder right now, and my confidence is even more booming because of the correlation between prayer, blood pressure coming down, heart rate coming down. I was so ready to get out of there by day three. I had everybody in the room, you know, just like, Doc, I need to go. It's time to go. It's like, well, let's just wait a little bit longer here. And then the heart rate would jump back up again. It's like, man, see, you guys are making me frustrated right now. I need to go, you know. And so it's like, well, let's just take some more time to rest, and let's just make sure. And basically, the last test was a CTA test where they wheel you in, you have you're laying in your bed, then they pick you up and they lay you on this gurney kind of thing. And there's a big, huge tube that you have to go under, and then they insert your body with some fluid, I can't remember the name of the fluid, some contrast, and so they put the dye in and everything, and you feel this dye going through your whole body, and then you get entered into this time warp machine. Sounds like you're in Star Trek, and you're looking up, and everything is going in circles and everything, and they're saying, Jermaine, it's on the microphone, they're like, Jermaine, just calm down, just relax, and I'm like, okay, I'm trying, you know, just like, just stay relaxed, and the heart rate just kept going up and up and higher and higher and higher, and then they have to bring me out, and then wait, and then give me more medication, then enter me into the machine, and then wait, and then the emergency response team was there, and when the emergency team comes in, you know that it's starting to escalate, and I'm like, what are you here for? Well, I'm here just in case something happens here. Okay, well, you want me to relax? but the emergency team is here. So I had some jokes that I threw back at them as well. I said, it's all good. You know, just do what you got to do. And so we went through that process about three separate times. And on the third time, the third day that you get wheeled in there, and now you have more blood pressure cuffs and you have all this stuff that you're connected with, you just start to eventually get to a point where you just let go and just let God do his thing. It's like, you know, the church knows the message if I die today. You know, my family knows what I stand for. I can die today. And I didn't even feel scared. It was like one of the first times that I wasn't really afraid to die. And I know I've said that figuratively, but I really meant it at that point. And I was like, I think my message is clear. And so I just wanted to take a few minutes to thank you guys. And I have to slow down my talking so that I keep my heart rate in a certain pattern. So if I get excited, you know, everything rises up. But then I have to, you know, Stephanie's sitting there giving me that look like, hey, you know, you better keep it quiet today. But Stephanie ran 16 miles today. I thought that was pretty outstanding. She's out there making it happen. And she's like, yeah. I gave her that ice bath. She wasn't saying, yeah. Then she's like, oh, it's so cold. And she got an ice bath and everything. That inspired me. And I was like, man, I need to go out there and jog a couple miles myself. And so I got a chance to enjoy the sun, enjoy the family. And I just appreciate being alive. So I feel encouraged. It's kind of weird, right? Do you clap? Do you not clap? Don't worry. I don't care about the claps. I'm just saying, I just feel like literally grateful to be alive. Like grateful. Sincerely. And my purpose is ever more apparent and obvious. So with that being said, let's go ahead and transition. I just wanted to take some time to just say thank you to all of our family and friends online, my birth mom there in Houston, Texas, my family members that I haven't heard from. If you're online, I haven't seen you in 10 years or talked to you in 15 years, but it's so great that you tuned in to pray for me. I appreciate that. I appreciate the CCU family. I appreciate the disciples all over the world that have threw some prayers our way. And I'm very humbled to be considered somebody worthy to be prayed for. And so I just want to say thank you as I try to control my emotions to speak to you this evening. So at that time, let's go ahead and go in a word of prayer. And then I have some verses that I would like for us to go through as we think about what it means to build the church together. Because it's going to be very important for us to think about it in a sense of building it together. That's the only way that this job can get done. I think that's one of the lessons that I learned through the time. So I got tons of wheels turning. And it's important that everybody's turning their wheels at the same time so that we could get the same work done, but with not just fewer individuals, but all of us, and that makes the work light. So that's what's cool. That's one of the coolest lessons that I learned through it. Let's go ahead and go to God in prayer. God, thank you for this time to be together. Thank you so much for down times. Thank you for up times. Thank you for times of encouragement. Thank you for times of discouragement. For those are the times that we find ourselves and we find ourselves crying out to you in a very different voice. And Father, you show us your power. You show us your strength and you humble us by helping us to understand that you are in control. There is only one God. And Father, there is one Christ. And God, I want to thank you so much whom we come to worship, to whom we come to listen, to whom we come to ask the Holy Spirit and invite the Holy Spirit to stir in us a sense of purpose, to stir in us a sense of unity, to stir in us a sense of resolve, to just simply be the people that you called us to be and use the talents and skills that you've given us that we might be able to multiply them into this world, that this world might be a better place. And Father, jump into this presidential election and all these things going on in the world, God, is very important. I know that disciples are ready and engaged and spiritual and read up and prayed up and spirit-led to be able to present the solution for all the different challenges that our world faces today. Father, we know that Jesus is the answer to separation. We know that Jesus is the answer to craziness. We know that Jesus is the answer to hate. And God, I just want to pray that you'll help us to make that practical in our lives, that it might not just be a message that encourages our mind, but doesn't inspire our feet and hands to do and be what you've called us to do and be. Father, we love you. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So yeah, it's an interesting thing because it's time to concentrate in a different type of way and delegate and move through the Holy Spirit and let the Holy Spirit use us together to get the job done. Does that make sense? And so the title of this evening's message is simply Build Christ Church Together. Build Christ Church Together. Let's turn in our Bibles to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16. The Bible says in verse 13, Matthew chapter 16, Jesus is talking and Peter makes this confession and he proclaims something right here. And the Bible says in Matthew chapter 16, verse 13, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." This is a pretty awesome confession right here that the writer of Matthew was able to put into words for us to be able to go back and study. And what he says, "What about you? Who do you say I am?" And Peter has all this conviction. Peter has walked with Jesus. Peter has seen Jesus. Peter has seen Jesus on the go. Peter has seen Jesus heal the sick. Jesus he's touched the untouchable. Jesus was on the move, on the go, day in and day out. His love was simply amazing. And everybody's coming up with all these rumors. And these are some good men to think about Jesus. He said, "Some say John the Baptist." Well, John the Baptist was like one of the most powerful preachers of the day. He said, "Some say Elijah." Man, Elijah was one of the guys that stood up to the prophets of Baal. He says, "What about Jeremiah?" Jeremiah was the weeping prophet. He was the one that had to tell of God's judgment to come. And so these are some powerful examples of what the people thought about Jesus. And right here he says, still others, maybe one of the prophets. So Jesus had good company. But Jesus was not interested in what others thought. What he asked, and I think that's a valid question for us this evening, is he says, "But what about you? Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter didn't stutter. He didn't hesitate. What did he say? "You are the Christ. You are the Messiah. You are the Son of the living God. And I really appreciate that confession. It's the same confession that we take when we get baptized into Christ, that Jesus is Lord, Jesus is the Messiah, Jesus is our Savior. It's about Jesus. It's about Jesus. Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Happy are you, Simon, son of Jonah." That's what that word blessed means, superlatively happy. "Happy are you, Simon, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven." There was something that he spoke with such conviction that literally Jesus could look down to the very core of who he is. And he says, "Yep, you get it." And that's from the Father in heaven. That's from God right there. That conviction, that comes from God. That's not from some church leader. That's not from some church person. That's not some religious answer. That is from the Father. And he says, "For this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven." And he says, "I tell you that you are Petros," right? The rock. You are the rock. Petros, you are Peter. And he says, "And on this rock," Petros, on this fact, on this cornerstone, on this stone, "I will build my church." What was the Petros? What was the rock? The rock was the confession that he said, "You are the Christ." You are the Christ. He says, because of this fact, on this rock, on this cornerstone, on this fact, on this basis, I will build my church. Who's going to build the church? Jesus is going to build the church. Who's going to build the church? Jesus is going to build the church. He's going to do it through your fire. He's going to do it through your passion. He's also going to do it through your down times. He's also going to do it while you're in the hospital. He's going to do it through your ups and your downs. What is your testimony? Is Jesus the Son of God, no matter what the circumstance? He says, "I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock, I will build the church. On this fact, I will do it." On what fact? On your confession. Hey, I'm going to stand on your word. We stand on Jesus' word. What does Jesus do? I'm standing on your word. I'm standing on your life. I'm standing on your testimony. I'm standing on this fact, your revealed revelation that comes from the Father in heaven. Blessed are you. You got to be a happy camper, don't you? Because everybody thinks that I'm this guy or that guy. But you know who I am. You get it. But he said, "It's revealed to you by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not overcome it." And we got to have strong convictions about this. The gates of Hades will not overcome Christ's church. When the world looks like it is plummeting, and trust me, it looks like it is plummeting in the toilet. When the world goes postal, when nothing is working out in your family, when nothing is working out in your health, Jesus' church will still stand. Jesus is still and always will be Lord.
Amen.
You say, "God, man, I don't understand. Why are you allowing these things to happen? Why is he allowing it to happen? Really? Come on, let's get it real. It's happening because you're not taking a stand. You're not being the man that you need to be. You're not being the person you need to be. It happens one disciple at a time. That's why it's happening, bruh. That's why it's happening, sis. This is not my plan works. I know how to fix the world. It's called making disciples. You say, man, we got to figure this out. God, why are you allowing us to have? Bruh, the sin has been in the world. What are you going to do about it, disciple? What's your confession? Is Jesus the Christ? Yes. Okay, now what's your life? What's your excuse? You know, there is an expression that I loved hearing back in the day. It's called, put your excuse in the caboose. The caboose is the last train on the train, you know, the train tracks. It's the caboose. Put it in the back. Let your excuse be in the back, all right? Don't put it on the front. I can't do this. That's your first thing that you come up with. Well, I got this. I got that. First thing that you come up with. Hey, listen, lead with Christ, not your excuse. Lead with your confession, not your situation. You know, it's important for us to make sure that we understand that Christ is trying to do something. He's trying to simply build his church. That's it. That's it. And for that, we got to be really, really grateful, especially if you are a part of it. His church, the universal church. You say, man, the church is CCU. No. The church is that church over there. No. Man, I like that group over there. No, he's not saying that. He's talking about the universal called out. See, if you've been called out of the world, you will not look like the world. You will not smell like the world. You will not have the fragrance of the world. You will smell like Christ. When people look for answers, your answers of Christ come to the surface. When you have a room, when you don't have any control, and you're hooked up to all the machines, and you can't make phone calls, and you can't do anything, and all you have is your confession, what are you going to do then? Christ! Lead with Christ! Whether you have much or you have less, lead with Christ. Lead with Christ, lead with Christ. Christ is the answer. You say, Jermaine, man, what if you reach out to somebody and they're an atheist and they're helping you and they might sabotage the whole situation? So be it. So be it. Christ. You know, they put they give you a grease board and everything, and they put all the goals for the day, all the tests. I wish y'all could have saw all those tests. This test, this test, this test, this test. And then it says the main goal. That was one of the things. It says the main goal in the category. And I put, Yeshua is Adonai. That's the main goal. Every doctor that walked in, they look at the board and go, okay, so we have Yeshua is Adonai. Yeshua is Adonai. We take the blood pressure. Let's go ahead and take it. Oh my, what is this Hebrew word? Yeshua is Adonai. All I'm trying to tell you, all I'm trying to say is, what have I learned through this hospitalization? And then what is the message and the flow of what God is doing? You see, Noah made his great confession. Yeshua is Adonai. Jesus is Lord. You know, it was a great confession. All of us have made that confession. Jesus is Lord. That's the confession. Now, what is the life? It's no different than the confession. Now, man, dang. I don't know if I can be a part of something like that. Well, amen. Amen. Maybe you shouldn't. Maybe you shouldn't. But as far as me and my house, when I look at the evidence of the Bible and I look at the evidence of what Jesus has been doing, and I can't ignore what Jesus is. You see, there was none of my, and there were no business associates that came. There were no friends out there in the world, all the reputation that you can have in the world that would show up. You know who showed up? God did. You know who showed up? Disciples did. You know what God did? God's people, God's church, God, the Father, in my worst time. The thing that the doctor revealed to me, he said, you know, I go from room to room to room. And it's a dark place. I say, why is it a dark place? Because nobody knows the people that are in the hospital. They just don't know them. Nobody comes to visit them. Nobody comes to see them. Da 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 da. And I was like, well, amen. You know, I'm not here to brag about what the church is doing, but I am here to brag about God. And I feel very boastful about God. I feel boastful at the end when me and the doctor, we're going through all the different tests and we're scratching our head at the end. He said, well, looks like all the tests just came back and they all came back perfectly healthy heart. Honestly, I have no idea how this happened because you had a blood pressure of a 215. So we should expect to see some plaque. We should expect to see something on the heart, but we see no evidence of any of that. So I guess we're just going to have to chalk this up to, I was like, Yeshua is Adonai. And I appreciate with one of the medical people, they came in and said, it seems like there's a lot of work for you to do that's yet to be done. And I was like, you know what? I think you might be right. Would you like to come? Check it out sometime. Build my church together. Let's build my church together. I think that one of the lessons that I've got to learn as a 50-year-old, and 50-year-olds can still learn, don't worry. I know that we're old. Nathan's like, whoa, 50 is so old. I know, it's so old. It's so right. 50-year-olds need to learn too. And one of the greatest things that I think I can learn is how to inspire those that are within reaching distance of my voice, friendships that we have, how can I help them to be fruitful in their lives for Jesus Christ? It does no good for us to have one or two people doing it. No, that's good. That's awesome. One or two people do it, amen. Man, that's more than a lot of churches. We're in a church building right here that is dying, just so you know. This big building has a children's ministry of like two people or something like that. It's not about the building. It's not about anything. What it's about is helping each individual in here do what they're supposed to do. And somehow coming alongside and just running a race together, right, Kenneth? When somebody's struggling, when they're running and they're training and they're trying to run up a hill or something like that, I mean, they got to run their race. They still got to do their part. They got to put the one foot in front of the other. As Stephanie was trucking along today, 16 miles, you know, trucking along, trucking along, trucking along. She's got to do her part, but that encouragement also helps. The support also helps. Man, my question for us that are watching online and those that are on social media is, do you want to be effective for Jesus? Do you want to be effective for Jesus in your life? If you want to be effective for Jesus, we got to walk as disciples of Jesus. That's the only way. The only way. And somehow I have to convince us of that. So I know that our brains are vibrating and things like that, and our brains agree, but somehow the activity, somehow it doesn't triculate down to the feet and hands, right? To the vocal cord, to the places alone when you're by yourself, struggling with impurity, struggling with looking at videos, struggling with setting an example for the people that God has put in your life. But it's okay, because guess what? Maybe your blood pressure is 215 spiritually. Maybe it looks like you're about to die. But guess what? I'm still here. Guess what? You're still here. Guess what? We can change now. Guess what? I got to change my diet. Guess what? I got to transform. Don't feel sorry for me. So what? I got to stop eating Cheetos. I got to stop eating fast food. I got to stop drinking all this soda pop. I got to stop doing a bunch of stuff. So what? Don't feel sorry for me. Just say, let's go. You want to live the next stage of your life, or you want to sit there and whine and complain of all the stuff that you can't do, all the excuses of this and that, and all the stress that you feel of this and that, and the finances of this and that, and all this stuff. You got the perfect little potion for your excuses. Your excuses need to get in the cabooses. So I don't expect y'all to feel sorry for me. Don't worry. I don't expect that. I know I'm going to be pushed. I know I'm going to be encouraged. I know I'm going to be loved. And that's what it's like to be a part of a family. Encouraged, pushed, loved. Encouraged in our marriage. Do we want a marriage that shines for God? Yes. Encouraged, pushed, loved. Maybe you have no idea how to share your faith. Encouraged, pushed, loved. Maybe you've never made a disciple in your life. You need to be encouraged, pushed, loved. Man, I don't know what it's like to have consistent quiet times. I don't think I've had 7 for 7 reading the Bible 7 days out of 7 days in a long time. You just need to be encouraged, pushed, and loved. That's it. That's the thing that I learned about my beautiful wife coming to the hospital every day. Why? To encourage me, to push me. She would have those little subtle little It's like, yeah, I'm grateful to be here, but Jermaine, you have got to change your eating. Okay, Stephanie, can you just go ahead and exit the door? I'm trying to. Okay. Excuse me, let me hit a nurse. It's a little more encouraging. Yes, what can I do for you, Mr. Peacock? Can you bring me a Coca-Cola? No, I didn't say that. Don't worry. But that's kind of the equivalent of what we do sometimes with. The encouragement that we get, we ignore it and then just go back to whoever satisfies us. Guys, the friendships that are in your life that are the least resistance, the friendships in your life that don't care about your soul, those friendships are going to meet the maker someday, and so will you. You have to make sure that you are surrounding yourselves with the right camp, the right thought, the right people that will help you push through the door. Now, don't go and create a monk, get up in the mountains and, all right, I got my boys, and you just got yourself and you away from the world. No, guys, no. Just be you. Just be you. You are what God is looking for. Seriously. You are, don't worry, you're not the answer. He's the answer. But you are the vessel for the answer to get to your friends. You are the vessel for your coworkers to perhaps make it. You say, Jermaine, what if my coworkers say no? What if my friends say no? What if my family says no? You got to keep on living life. Just because your family doesn't reach out to you and your family is not receptive and your coworkers are not receptive and maybe your friends that you like are not receptive doesn't mean that you quit. Just because, let me translate it practically, okay? Just because everybody drinks soda, just because everybody eats pizza, just because everybody eats junk food, just because everybody does all that stuff, it doesn't mean that I need to engage in that activity. I'm surrounded by it every day. Just because all the coaches talk about women, they talk about crazy stuff, and they talk about all this stuff, it doesn't mean I have to engage in that. I have to be resolved that Jesus is Lord. It doesn't mean that I become religious. It just means that, man, what would Jesus do in this situation? How would Jesus love this dude? Man, if he tells me no 25 times in the next 25 weeks, Jesus is going to continue to love him. When does Jesus tell me to do this next? I think we just got to be on point with that. So, amen. I got on my soapbox with that. Let's move along the message. So, one of the things that I'm excited about is that the Bible says here, Jesus says, I will build my church. And he says, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. So, we got to see ourselves as part of God's church. God's called out, and you are moving forward. As a group of disciples, as a called out group, not as a called out individual, as a called out group. Maybe you feel weak, but there's another brother that's by your side that's a little stronger than you on this day or that day. You guys still move together. You still move down the line. You still do it, right? There is a team. There's team involvement here. Sometimes you're going to be up. Sometimes you're going to be down. Sometimes you're going to be strong. Sometimes you're going to not be strong. Sometimes you just... But because you're part of the team, it's still moving forward. When you are weak, somebody else is strong because your focus is the same. Your spirit is unrelenting. Your spirit says, I'm going to continue to go for it. I'm going to continue to be. Now, when you have to slow down, you have to slow down. But guess what? The brothers and sisters that are around you, they will then pick up the parts that are dropping, right? And you keep moving forward. We got to move forward as a church. He says, I will build my church. And so... very excitingly, we've decided to call our Bible studies. We're going to have some Bible studies that we put together. It's called Build My Church. Christ said, I will build my church. So that's the name of the studies, Build My Church. And so we're pretty excited about that. The different studies that we're working on right now, it's going to be an evangelistic Bible study series. And the whole purpose of the Bible study series is to really begin to speak as one voice, to speak as one group of people, trying to help as many people become disciples as possible. And we're excited about building Christ's church. Christ says that he will build the church. He says, I will build the church. We are the walking vessels right there. It's an evangelistic thing. Let's turn in our Bibles to Psalm chapter 103. Psalm chapter 103. Psalm 103. Everybody there? Almost? Psalm 103. The Bible says, Psalm 103, verse 13, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. For as a man, his days are like what, church? Grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. The wind blows it over and it's gone. And its place remembers no more. From everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who what, church? Fear him. Where's the Lord's love? It's with those that fear him. That means revere him. That means you subject yourself to him. That means that you respect him. All right. And his righteousness with their children's children. And I love this passage right here, because in the beginning of our evangelistic Bible studies, what we like to do is we like to start with the story. What's the story? We got to be good listeners, right? What's the story, man? I want to hear your story. What's your story? And I think engaging in that conversation, what's your story? I really want to know your testimony. I want to know your story. What's your situation? So that's what we start out with. We start out with the story, and then what we'll do is we'll equip the church as to how to go through the basic story of God, right? In the beginning, right? We know Genesis chapter 1:1. Let's turn there. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, right? So it starts with God. Let's go to Genesis chapter 3. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 3, now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say you must not eat of any tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. You will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows when you eat of it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good from evil. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, And they realized that they were naked, so they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord as he was walking through the garden in the cool of the day. They hid from the Lord God among the trees in the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" And he answered, "I heard you in the garden. I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, so I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is it that you've done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock, above all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust, and all the days of your life, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. And he will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." He's talking about Jesus right there. "To the woman," he said, "I will greatly increase your pains in childbearing, and with pain you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you." To Adam, he said, "Because you have listened to your wife and ate from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat of it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you. You will eat the plants of the field by the sweat of your brow. You will eat of your food until you return to the ground, since that is where you were from taken. From dust you are, and to dust you will return." And then the Bible goes on. You know, as we engage in the story, it's going to be important for us to make the connection and then tell God's story. This story in Genesis is a story that is repeated throughout time. It's also repeated in our lives, and it also has a picture of Jesus coming to save us from the mistakes that we as human beings make, all right? And so we have to be in touch with the story of the Bible. Can you tell the story of the Bible? Can you talk about the Bible? Can you at least give a basic summary of the Genesis story to Revelation in sort of a 15-minute conversation? We want to train the church to be able to do so. And I believe the Bible does encourage us and move us in a direction where we have historical evidence of what God's story is, and our job is to connect God's story with their story. Amen. You follow? Amen. So it starts with the story. So that takes some time to listen. That takes time to set up coffee. You meet at home. You meet on Zoom, wherever you need to meet. But we start off with the story. And then we move to the Word, right? The Word of the Heavenly Father. And basically here, we hear from God the Father. We hear about his word. Look here in Psalm chapter 119, verse 105. Psalm 119, verse 105. The Bible says, Psalm 119, and we'll pick it up in verse 105. It says this: Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. That's what the word is. It's like a lamp, right, church? Your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. God's Bible, God's word, will light the way. That's what it's going to do. The word is going to equip us. The Bible tells us in 2 Timothy 3:16 to 17. You know, the Bible tells us that all scripture is God-breathed, that it's useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be what? Thoroughly equipped for every good work. So we want to equip people with the word of God. We want to help people understand that the word is the lamp. The word is the light. The word is going to bring the answers, all right? When we move through that study, we move to the way. All right? So you got the story. You got the story down. You understand their story. You're telling God's story. Then you got the word, right? It's about God's word, not our word. What does the Father say about his word? All right? Then we move to the way. This is the call of Jesus Christ. This is discipleship. This is learning to become a learner, training yourself to become a learner, training those that you study the Bible with to become a learner. So this is a step in the process to learn. To learn. It's not just you become a disciple, you get baptized, and then everything is done. No, the problem is not your salvation. The problem is you never thought about the fact that you've just started class 101, all right? You are now entered into the fraternity of Jesus Christ. You're now learning how to walk like Christ. So that's what the way is all about. Look in John chapter 14, verse 6. John chapter 14, verse 6. The Bible just says, John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So this study is all it's going to be about Jesus' way. What does Jesus expect? What does Jesus show us? This is the call of Jesus Christ. This is becoming a learner. We want to hear from Jesus, the Son of God. Then we move to the gospel study. Well, the gospel study is pretty awesome, right? We got the passion of the Christ. We got God's sacrifice. We got the cross. Man, why was the cross necessary? What does a person do? Well, they just simply believe the gospel, all right? They believe the gospel. Look here in Matthew chapter 26, verse 13. Matthew chapter 26, verse 13. The Bible says here, Matthew chapter 26, verse 13, I tell you the truth, that wherever this gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. This, of course, is the account of Jesus being anointed at Bethany. But it's interesting because the Bible actually says, I tell you the truth, wherever this gospel is preached throughout the world. Did you know that Jesus expects his gospel to go throughout the world? Yeah, it's expected to go throughout the world. Whenever this gospel is told, what she has done, it will be told in memory of her. And so, yeah, we're going to talk about the gospel message. We're going to talk about the cross, right? And then we move to our next study. The next study will be the conviction. Well, what's the conviction? Man, I'm convicted of my sinfulness. I'm convicted of it's sort of the study about the guilt of man, all right? It goes all the way back to the Genesis account. It shows the law of God. It shows how the Holy Spirit convicts. What is our response when the Holy Spirit convicts? Well, we are called to repent. We're called to be convicted. We're convicted by the Holy Spirit. The message of the gospel has come. The response is repentance. Look in John chapter 16, verse 18. John chapter 16, verse 18. The Bible says in John 16, verse 18, they kept asking, what does this mean? By a little while, we don't understand what he's saying. Jesus saw that they wanted to ask him about what he said. Are you going to ask another what I meant when I said, in a little while, you will see me no more. And then after a little while, you will see me. I tell you the truth, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. And he goes on and he continues to talk about some different components here. Let's look here. Let's look up in verse 11. The Bible says, in regard to judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned, and I have much to say to you, more than you can bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. And that's what the Holy Spirit's going to do, guide us into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only as what he hears, and he will tell you what yet is to come. He will bring glory to me by taking from what is mine and making it known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. This is why I said the Spirit will take from what is mine and make it known to you. In a little while, you will see me no more. And then after a little while, you will see me. What we're going to do with this study, guys, is basically we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit's job is to convict us of our sinfulness and convict us of what our actions have done in being responsible for putting Jesus on the cross. And then it goes to the response. Well, what is our response? We all know the scripture there in Acts chapter 2, verse 36. The Bible is pretty clear right there. And the Bible just simply says, Acts chapter 2, verse 36, "Therefore let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Well, this is the response. Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call." So, yeah, that's the response. Man's response, man, humility. Man, Jesus, what do you want me to do? Okay, this is what you are to do. Okay, I'm going to do it. I'm going to be baptized. I'm going to be added into God's church. And then that closes our last study with the church, right? So Ephesians chapter 4, we'll close with this. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, the Bible says, "As a prisoner of the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received." Right? So we got to remember that as the church, the word church in the Greek is the word ecclesia, and the word ecclesia just simply means the called out, right? So as a prisoner of the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling. That's that calling right there. You have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. That's what we're supposed to do in the church. Making every effort to keep the unity. That's what we're supposed to do in the church. Of the Spirit through the bond of peace. It's supposed to be peace in the church. There is one body. See, there's just one body. That's the church right there. There's one body, one Spirit, just as you were called. To the one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father over all, who is over all and through all and in all. So we're going to talk about the church right there. What does it mean to remain in Christ? And then how do we help each other to remain in Christ? So I'm looking forward to fleshing a lot of this out over the next several weeks, and it's going to be a great time. Some of you that have been recently baptized, we have, you know, we used to call them follow-up times, follow-up studies. We're going to just call them follow-through studies, all right? Follow-through. Let's just follow through with what we have learned. Let's build on top of what God has already done. Let's add to what God says in His Word. This is what we should be as people, right? So that's your follow-through. Very exciting times to think through the Build My Church Bible studies, and we'll be talking about that more. I said a handful this evening, but I just wanted to give you just a quick overview as we begin to jump into these Bible studies over the next several weeks. So with that being said, as you guys know, it's very important that we take time to celebrate what Jesus has done for us. And what has He done for us, Blaine? He died for us, right? What did He do for us, Chris? He hung on the cross for us. What did He do for us, Stephanie? Man, He resurrected from the dead. And for those reasons, you know, we come together every Sunday to remember Jesus, to remember what He did for us, that He came and He died on the cross. And as we take the bread and we take the cup, we remember the bread, we remember the life of Jesus, that He came into this world and He died for us. In the midst of everything going on in your life, and trust me, I don't know, I got a lot of catching up to do, being in the hospital and stuff like that. I'm looking forward to catching up with everybody today and the next several weeks. Prayerfully, God, give me life, you know. But at the end of the day, as you take the bread, please remember that Jesus came into this world, and he did it. He did it. He walked. He was the great physician. Yeah. He touched the untouchable. Maybe you feel like you can't do it. This is too much or whatever it is. Jesus got you. And when you take the cup, remember the blood that was spilled on that cross. He bled for you. He bled for you. I had a hard time bleeding for me. Okay, the blood people came in. They were like, I was like, okay, yeah, no more, no more, no more. But Jesus voluntarily bled for us. That right there is just amazing. And his blood is pure. The pure lamb bled for you and me. Let's pray for the bread and the cup. Amen. God, thank you for this time to be together. I do want to pray that you'll be with us as we take communion together. God, I want to pray that you transform us to be your church that's on the move and moving forward for you. I want to pray that you help to construct the church the way that you would like the church to be constructed. But God, I want to thank you so much for what you did through sending us Jesus. He walked in this world. He taught in this world. He lived in this world. He showed us how to live. He is truly the way. Thank you so much for the cup that represents his blood. He bled for us. And Father, we're so grateful for the blood of Jesus. God, thank you so much for this evening. Thank you for this time of worship. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
good. It felt really good. Amen. Just want to take a few moments just to pray for the contribution. Just want to remind everyone that our contributions, they go toward giving us an incredible facility to be able to meet. It goes toward the preaching of the word. There's so much that goes into your giving. And so the first thing is I want to say thank you guys so much for continuing to be faithful in your giving, because it multiplies the work forward. Things continue to happen. Things continue to move forward. And I also want to encourage you, if you've gotten, if maybe you've forgotten, or maybe you just have gotten kind of out of the flow, I just want to remind you that it's very important that we stay in touch with what God is doing and continue to give consistently. And because God continues to give to us consistently, even when I don't deserve it, which is pretty awesome. So let's go ahead and pray for the contribution. Let's continue to stay on top of giving back to God. Amen. There's a website, www.christchurchuniversal.org. You can click the donate button there, and then it'll go into the right place. Let's go ahead and pray for the contribution. God, thank you so much for this time to continue to worship. Thank you so much for your word. Thank you so much for your testimony. Thank you so much for giving to us. God, I want to pray that you will empower us, that we might be able to give back to you in some small way. Father, we know that our gifts to you are small in comparison to the gifts that you've given us. But Father, I just want to pray that you'll help us to be responsible stewards of what you have given us. And I just pray that you'll take all the gifts that are given and multiply your work. Multiply the people studying the Bible, multiply our band, continue to add to what you are doing in our children's ministry. God, continue to add to our number with just seeing just here recently Blair and Noah getting baptized. And God, I just want to pray that you will help us to know, just being one with giving, Father, we can never outgive you. And we're so grateful for the ways that you've given. Father, I love you. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand on up for one last song. Jesus is on the main line. Tell him what you want. Thank you.
Amen. It's so great to see all of you here online. It's so awesome to see all of you here. It's so great to have all of you here online and here in person. Let's have a great fellowship. We love you guys. We'll see you next week, okay?